Welcome to TalkNorth.com. Thanks to our longtime producer, Brandon Morton. Please download before you listen. If you'd like to advertise with us, you can reach us at TalkNorthPodcast@gmail.com. And please follow us on Twitter at TalkNorthPod. Two promo codes to be aware of. Bitesquad.com, use the promo code TalkNorth to get your first delivery free. And go to SodaStick.com, the great local apparel company. Use the promo code YouBetcha to get free shipping on any sized order. We have angry fans, Roy. We can fan the flames, or we can try to calm them down. Maybe we'll do a little bit of both here. We are getting into real free agency now. Stuff is happening, and we will tell you about it. This is Roy Smalley's Chin Music, our baseball show on TalkNorth.com. Please follow us on Twitter at TalkNorthPod. We'll have some interesting developments for our network over the next couple of months. And thank you to our producer, Brandon Morton. Thank you also to our sponsors. Longtime sponsor, Barry Coffee, barrycoffee.com. We have some interesting news developments with Barry Coffee coming up as well. And Tony Hoaglund, your State Farm agent who works out of Champlin, H-O-A-G-L-U-N-D. He handles my insurance. All right, so Zach Wheeler, the Twins make an offer. He does not accept it. He signs for $118 million over 5 years with the Phillies. Cole Hamels signs 1 year, $18 million with the Braves. The Twins still need starting pitching. Are you as panicked as the average Twins fan about these developments?
No, I'm not. I mean, we know going in that the Twins are going to be in the running and reasonable. And I think that's the right answer, not to overpay and get your club in a bind from a lot of money to one person standpoint. But I will say this: I mean, the reported offer is $100 million. They reportedly Twins offered $100 million, $18 million over 5 years, so a little over $3.6 million or whatever that is a year more from the Phillies. And when you get down to that, now, I mean, $3.6 million a year is, you know, it's a lot of money. I'm not saying that it's not. But when you're that close, there are other things that are making the decision for you as a player. And if the Twins had gone to $120 million, and outspent the Phillies by a couple of million bucks, he might still very well sign with the Phillies. I mean, it's in the league he's comfortable in. It's in the division he's comfortable in. It's close to his wife's family, which I understand was a big part of that decision. So when, there's no guarantee, just like everybody wanted Zach Greinke last year and without, the knowledge that Greinke had the Twins as a team he would never be traded to ever in his contract. So, there are things that go on. And when you're that close, I mean, I think that's a bona fide attempt by the Twins. But at some point in time, you say, if I've got to spend $130 million to get his wife to agree not to be so close to home, then maybe it's starting to become not worth it.
Yeah, and everything you brought up is true. It was reported by Lavelle Neal and I think other outlets as well. We know it's true. The Twins offered 5 years for $100 million. He signs for 5 years, $118 million. And given all the personal ties to the East Coast, the Twins might have had to go $25 million a year to get him. And right. Let's remind people, the contract, the most complained about contract in Minnesota sports history was Joe Mauer coming off an MVP season as a St. Paul native and Minnesotan going into a new ballpark. Signed for $23 million a year, and all we heard for 8 years was complaints about it every day of the calendar year. This guy would have been signing $25 million a year as a guy who's never pitched 200 innings. It kind of profiles to be a nice number three starter. I my stomach would not allow me to – if I were the Twins, I could not stomach that kind of an investment in a player who's not a star.
Yeah, I really think that's right, and I think we're seeing the market a lot higher than anybody expected, and it's you know, that kind of money for Zach Wheeler after, you know, after the injuries that he's had and the way he's pitched. I mean, he's got a big arm. He's got a chance to be really good for the Phillies. I hope he is. Best of luck. But boy, that kind of money on one player. And your example is exactly the right one. Everybody saw what it appeared to do to the Twins' ability to get other players when they're paying one guy that much, and everybody was unhappy with it. Now you're going to do that again for a guy that's going to pitch once every 5 days and has never pitched 200 innings before and has been injured. It would have been real hard for me to do.
Yeah, and Cole Hamels signs 1 year, $18 million with the Braves. Now, I like 1 year contracts. You get a player who's highly motivated. You get, if it ends up being an overpayment, it doesn't kill your future plans. It just, takes a little nick out of you that year. Nobody's going to, let's face it, it's not our money. We're not going to worry too much about that. But Cole Hamels, second half of last season, 5.76 ERA. $18 million for a guy who faded. That just, I'm not saying it's a bad deal because, again, I like one-year deals, but I don't think that we should look at Cole Hamels as someone who would have fixed everything here either.
There's no question that's true. He would be a nice addition at a reasonable price, potentially. But again, you just don't know. He's up there in age. He had a bad second half of the season, and pitching in the American League with the designated hitters and that's tough on guys. I mean, I really think it would have been the same kind of gamble. The only difference, in terms of what the performance was going to turn out to be for $18 million, but the only thing about that is that it was a 1 year deal, and if it didn't work, it didn't work. And again, we're playing fast and loose with somebody else's money for $18 million and saying, well, if it doesn't work, it doesn't work. They can't afford to play it fast and loose. They have to really think about where resources are going. And I'm going to lose any sleep over not getting Cole Hamels either.
Would you lose sleep over not getting Madison Bumgarner? He's a really interesting case because he's had, he's been really good for a long time. Career ERA 3.13, 3.90 last year, not as great, but 34 starts, 207 innings pitched. Has not only proven himself in the postseason, has been spectacular in the postseason. Is he the kind of guy you break the bank for?
Again, his age.
He's 30. He'll turn 31 in August.
Right, and so it just depends on where the market's going to be for him. I actually like Bumgarner a lot. I like the idea of him in a Twins uniform an awful lot. And the reason I do is for the reasons that you mentioned, plus the fact that he's a gamer. He's a real competitor. He's a veteran guy that I think would be of great impact on the Twins pitchers. He's left-handed in a predominantly right-handed rotation so far with the Twins. I like that an awful lot. But again, for a guy that's going to turn 31 next year, who's lost some velocity and is going to, be pitching in, for the first time in the American League against DHs and all that kind of stuff, you can't pay, you can't pay too much. And I think that we'll just have to see what the market is. But I think in the $18 million range is probably going to be pretty compelling for the Twins try if they can get him in that range. That's probably something worth considering, I would say, because of who that guy is.
Let's talk about some fallback options if they don't get Bumgarner. I have a bunch of ideas of my own. I'm interested to hear what you think. I do want to thank our primary sponsor, Barry Coffee, barrycoffee.com. We just got an email from Steve Brem from Barry Coffee, longtime founder and owner of Barry Coffee, a very service-oriented company with a very charismatic owner who goes out and does a lot of this stuff himself. He said he had a listener to our podcast walk in and buy a case of Bull Run Blend, which is, of course, what Roy and I drink. Also mentioned that he, you know, their new roaster is going to be is opening up, and we're going to go do an episode from the new roaster. That'll be cool because it means we get to sit there and drink coffee and hang out with some cool people. And you know, you've known Steve for a long time. It's not very surprising to get an email like that from him right before we come on the air.
Yeah, it's great. I just really enjoyed Steve and his service orientation so much. I'm glad listeners are availing themselves of, you know, walking in and buying a case of coffee. That's fun. Good for them. He'll never go back to anything else. I'm confident in that. But I think about Steve, and just the email we got is just kind of who he is as a guy, and that you know, permeates the organization and gets into their service model. And I've talked about this a lot, but, you know, 24/7 service all over Twins territory, as it were. And you don't get that. There's so many clients that he gets because nobody provides that kind of service. The machine goes down in a place of business, and they call up and someone says, yeah, we can get somebody out there, you know, next Tuesday at 3:00. And with Barry Coffee, it's how late you open today, you know, kind of stuff. And it's fun to, you know, to know a guy like that and have that idea of service be rewarded the way it is.
Hey, we also recommend you follow Roy and myself on Twitter, and as well as Talk North Pod on Twitter. And I just retweeted something just apropos of nothing. I'm just being a complete geek here. Someone named a Twitter handle called MyBookie Sportsbook just put out one of the greatest baseball videos of all time. It's Japanese League, and I believe a Japanese pitcher drills a guy. I'm guessing he's an American player. He's a very large, muscular guy. And the guy proceeds to chase this guy, the pitcher, all over the ballpark while two rosters try to tackle them both. It's great. So it's on my Twitter feed, or I would go to my bookie sportsbook on Twitter. It's fantastic. I got to get the backstory. We'll talk about that in a few. Hey, so let's talk about like recovery plans. Let's say they don't get Bumgarner. I can still see this working out. And here's my way that it could possibly work out. You have Berríos and Odorizzi at the top of the rotation. That works. Your fifth starter is probably Devin Smeltzer or Littell or Dobnak. That's not bad for a fifth starter. Any of those guys could end up overachieving at that position or some combination of the three. And, you know, the other two give you some nice bullpen depth. So you got two slots to really worry about there. I could see them bringing back Pineda. He'd be eligible again in May. They babied him through this year, and he still got 140, 150 innings out of him. And then, you know, you got a guy who has a fresh arm coming to help your team in May, somebody who knows how to pitch. That wouldn't be a bad thing for me. That would leave you with one large hole to fill in the rotation. And that's where I wonder if Graterol ends up contributing heavily. And maybe, who knows, maybe not right away. Maybe they have to kind of piece things together with some bullpen days early in the season. But, you know, if Graterol emerged this year as a reliable starter, then all of a sudden the piecing together rotation argument becomes much easier to make.
It does. And I think there's every chance that Graterol is going to help the club one way, you know, in one fashion or another, quite a bit this year and probably early on. He's interesting as a starter. And, I think we've seen what his potential could be out of the bullpen. I think I mentioned this in previous shows. I had a great conversation with Derek Falvey in New York before one of the playoff games this past postseason, and he talked to me about how the difference in the baseball really changed Graterol's effectiveness, and he really had to adjust to the smaller seams, and he said he was throwing legitimate 100 in double A with the other ball, and his breaking ball was better, everything was good, he's striking people, missing bats, and when he got to triple A, they were using the big league ball, things changed a little bit, and they brought him up, and it, you know, you could see him throwing 99 miles an hour, but but the carry not being there. He wasn't throwing it by guys like, I mean, Odorizzi was throwing 8 or 9 miles an hour slower, was throwing the ball, you know, by people. So there is something to carry. There is something to how this Ort regime is developing pitchers. And, you know, they may, he may, as he gets, is they've either changed the base.